بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، our praise is due for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him and we ask Allah to send His blessings and salutations upon His pure and noble messenger and upon those who follow Him exactly in faith. And about witness, there is no true God worthy of worship except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is, without partner to be associated with Him. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and messenger. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'd like to welcome our brothers and sisters to our series of talks entitled SOS, Saving Our Souls from the Hellfire. Inshallah, it will be a four-part series. The first of these today, inshallah, is centered around the topic of sins and the effects of sins on the human. Alhamdulillah, every single person that has ever been born has been born that with the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His wisdom and knowledge, created us that we would sin. And of course, from the very first human, Adam alayhi salam, when he disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the result of that was harm. Whenever a human being falls into sin, the person harms themselves. And the majority of this topic today, or these four topics, or four series we should say, will be based on the book Al-Kaba'ir for Imam Al-Dhahabi, who was one of our Muslim scholars. His actual name is Shamsuddin Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ahmed ibn Uthman ibn Qayman. And he was a scholar who lived in Turkman, which is part of Turkey, if I'm correct. And then later in his life, he moved to Damascus. He was born in the year 673 Hijri. And as part of his search for knowledge, he traveled to many places. One of those places was Cairo in Egypt. Besides that, he visited many countries. But before he died, he was a scholar who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that his sight be taken, and he became blind before his death. He was a great scholar of hadith. He memorized many hadith, and he was also a great historian as well. He chronicled the Islamic history as well. So brothers and sisters, we want to ask ourselves a question today. What is sin? Now, I could easily give you the answer, but I'd like to have some interaction. So, from the brothers in the audience here, anybody care to share with us the knowledge about what is sin? Even our young brothers.
Disobedience of Allah.
Jazakallah. Yeah. Our brother said, disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without doubt. When we talk about sins, these are the actions that a person does which is in direct contradiction, that they do the opposite of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only orders for us that which is good and pure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows us better than our own selves, for He's a creator. And just like if you have, let's say for example, somebody invented a car. That inventor, that creator of the car, knows exactly the mechanisms, knows its top maximum torque and its output. If something goes wrong with it, that designer, that inventor will know what's gone wrong with it and know the solution to it. In a similar way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our designer, who knows us inside out, has given us a guidance to live our lives. And the minute we move away from this guidance, that's when the harm starts to fall to us. And therefore, it is really very important that every single Muslim is aware of what sins are and the effect that they have. Now, when we talk about sins, in Arabic there are two terms, ma'asiyah and dhanb. They are both sins. However, ma'asiyah has been described as being those which are extremely dangerous because they are directly or intentionally committed, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be displeased with that. And these are the most dangerous of sins. Dhanb is a person may do a sin, maybe he did it unintentionally. But when someone is ma'asiyah, then this is intentionally done, knowing that this will cause Allah's displeasure. As the topic is about saving our souls from sins, we need to then ask ourselves that what constitutes sin? Now, as our brother mentioned, it is anything which will cause Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be upset and angry with us. However, we add something onto that as well. We can say it is that which is forbidden by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or that which opposes His Sunnah. When we talk about Sunnah, we're talking about His spoken words, His actions, or what He approved of. If we oppose this, then we can be falling into sins as well. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises, warns anybody, promises anybody who avoids the major sins that they will be forgiven their minor sins. And the proof of this is in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. That if you leave off, avoid the most noxious, the most horrible, the most dangerous of those sins, that which you're forbidden to do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we shall remit your evil deeds. Allah says He will forgive your sins. And this, the scholars mentioned, these are the minor sins. And admit you to a gate of great honor. Meaning, into the gates of paradise and into Jannah. So in this text, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, or has promised, that if you avoid the major sins, you will get your admittance to paradise. SubhanAllah. Here, what we learn, or what we should learn, about are what are the major sins. By avoiding the major sins, there'll be a chance for the minor sins to be erased, to be rubbed off. Some of the scholars, they said that the major sins are only seven. And this is based upon the hadith, or the meaning of the hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, avoid the seven heinous sins, the seven really bad sins. Worshipping others with Allah. Sorcery, doing magic. Taking a life which Allah has made sacred except in the course of justice. Devouring usury, riba, interest. Appropriating the property of the orphan, eating up the orphan's property without you having the right to it. Fleeing from the battlefield, running in the time of jihad when the enemy is facing you. And charging believing women, meaning accusing them of doing haram when they didn't do anything. Unmindful, though innocent, with adultery. So those are the seven sins which some of the scholars say that the which are the major sins. However, what we find from Ibn Abbas radiallahu anh, he said that these, which are counted as seven, are not, but they are rather 70. They're not seven, rather they are 70. And this is one of the points of view which is held by the majority of scholars. Even though the hadith doesn't point to a specific number, however, many of the scholars they follow the wording of Ibn Abbas, and this is what Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala wrote his book based upon this. So anything that which is done in terms of sins, if you were to redefine that, any action which if you did it could be punishable by the Sharia. Okay? Now it might be mentioned explicitly, clearly in the Quran, or it could be found through the hadith of Rasulullah that they would require the had, the punishment. Or that one who did this action is cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or by his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they refer this as a major sin. Now, one thing we have to bear in mind is that not all sins are the same. Some have a greater degree of haram to them than others, but they're still as sins. Out of all of the sins, as we know, the greatest of them is to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a deity, as a Lord. This will come to later. What is it that makes a person go towards sin? Anybody? Can I read?
Desires,
hawa, lusts, shahwa. Anything else? Who is the greatest enemy to you?
Shaitan.
A shaitan, he has the greatest role to play in us committing sins. Why? Because shaitan, Iblis, when he failed to follow the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that was the first disobedience. Iblis used to be the best of worshippers. He is from the jinn, made from a smokeless flame. And before the creation of Adam alayhi salam, he was the example, the model worshipper, the one who worshipped Allah the best. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, and told Iblis, and told the malaika, the angels, to prostrate, not as a worship to Adam, but to test their obedience. And of course, the malaika, the angels, they're never disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But shaitan, his nature is mutakabbir, proud of himself. So what did he say? He said, this is a person you made from clay and you made from fire. I'm better than him. The first sin, the sin of pride, was what got shaitan Iblis out of the security and the pleasures of Jannah. And for that, Iblis, shaitan, he vowed, he made a promise that he will mislead every one of the creation. He said that he will mislead everyone, take you all to hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us of what he said, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ فَبِمَا غَوَيْتَنِي لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صِرَطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. Iblis said to Allah, give me a respite, give me a chance, leave me be until the day that they all raised up, meaning the day of judgment, the day of resurrection, Yawm al-Ba'ath. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, you are allowed respite, you'll be given that time, you will not be punished by me in that time period. And then Iblis said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you sent me astray, he's blaming Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, surely I will sit in wait against them, meaning the human beings. He will sit in wait, waiting to mislead you, waiting to do anything, take you away from Allah's path, waiting against them on your straight path. We know that the Prophet ﷺ, once he drew a line in the sand, and then from that line, he drew other lines coming off it. And he said, this is a straight path, I'm just paraphrasing that hadith. This is a straight path, that which I and my companions are upon. And these are the paths, at the end of them, indeed there's a shaitan waiting to mislead them. So the straight path we talk about, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, is a clear straight path, it's known to us. And any path that deviates, that strays away from it, will be the path going towards Jahannam. There is only one straight path. That is a path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us to follow, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is that path we need to follow. And as a result, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed the shaitan. Allah subhanahu says, لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ وَقَالَ لَأَتَّخِذَنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِكَ نَصِيبًا مَفْرُوضًا. Allah cursed him, and he, shaitan, said, look, subhanAllah has cursed him. His punishment, without any doubt, is in Jahannam, his final abode, his final resting place. But even then, he says to Allah, I will take an appointed portion of your slaves. There's a group of your believers, I'm taking with me to Jahannam. May Allah save us from being in that group. And he said, وَلَأُضِلَّنَّهُمْ وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلْيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامِ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلْيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذِ الشَّيْطَانَ وَلِيًّا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُبِينًا. Allah subhanahu wa says in the Quran what Iblis shaitan said, verily I will mislead them, and surely I will arouse in them false desires, and certainly I will order them to slit the ears of cattle, and indeed I will order them to change the nature created by Allah. And whoever takes shaitan as a wali, protector, a helper instead of Allah, has surely suffered a great loss, a manifest loss. Whoever listens to shaitan, what does he want? He wants to take you from Allah's path. He wants to do something opposite to what Allah wanted. And many of the scholars, they referred to this ayah, they said, he will put in you false desires. Make you think it's okay to do this, justify what you're doing, and change the nature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Incidentally, you see this in science, for example. You see examples of how the scientists want to, inverted commas, create different species. They take the eggs out, and they take out its DNA, and they try to make new hybrids, mixtures. And I remember a long time ago, not long ago, but one of the students asked, he asked, what is the Islamic ruling on genetic engineering? And at the time I was living in Saudi Arabia. So I asked this question to Sheikh Muhammad Saleh Munajjid, Hafizullah. And I explained to him what the genetic engineering entails, what does it mean, doing what? And the Sheikh referred to the same ayah, where he will order, shaitan that is, will order the human being to change nature created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Khaliq, huwa Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. At the end of the day, the scientists, aroused by these false desires to create, inverted commas, they've not created anything. They took what was already created, and they took a bit out here and tried to make something different, changing the nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had intended. And that is a great sin. And this is only because they listened to the shaitan and they followed that desire. Allahu a'lam. What does that shaitan do? We said he puts false desires. But these false desires, they're nothing. They're meaningless. In fact, it's a deception. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعِدُهُمْ يُمَنِّيهِمْ وَمَا يَعِدُهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. He, meaning the shaitan, makes promises to them and arouses them false desires, and shaitan's promise, or his promises, are nothing but deceptions. Masallah subhanahu wa ta'ala says not to follow his footsteps. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu udkhulu fis silmi kaffa. O you believe, enter into Islam fully, accept it all. Don't pick and choose. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. And don't follow the footsteps of the shaytan. إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. He is to you a clear enemy. That is shaytan. And whoever follows the shaytan, following his desires and lusts, for that person, what is left for that person? أولئك مأواهم جهنم. That the dwelling, the resting place for such people is Jahannam. ولا يجدون عنها محيصا. And they will find no way of escaping from it. نعوذ بالله. May Allah save us from that hellfire. So we have Shaytan. He is the greatest of the misleaders. He is the one who will push you toward doing sins, toward disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and trying to justify your actions any way possible. But then there's also Qareen. A Qareen is a personal jinn, a personal shaytan that every single one of us has with us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the Qareen in Surah Qaf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قال قرينه ربنا ما طغيته ربنا ما طغيته ولكن كان في ضلال بعيد. The Qareen, his Qareen will say, your personal shaytan, your devil, he will say, our Lord, I did not push him to do transgress, to do sins, to oppress, to do evil actions. But he himself was in error, he was far astray. That Qareen whispers to you, but at the end of the day, on the day of judgment, he will absolve himself, will free himself of all blame. You did the action, you take the blame for it. So at the end of the day, there's a constant struggle, or there has to be a constant struggle in the life of the Muslim against the Qareen. And the companions, when they asked the Prophet ﷺ, said, even you? He said, yes, even I have a Qareen, but my Qareen submitted, meaning the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and only orders to do good. So other than the Prophet ﷺ, each and every one of us carries our personal shaitan, personal devil with us. And that is each person's personal jihad against the desire, against their nafs. Always trying to check, making sure, are we doing obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or are we following in the footsteps of the shaitan? Brothers and sisters, we get to the next part, and that is the effect of sins, the effect of sins. Now sins can affect not only an individual, but a community, a nation. And one of the punishments that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He sent was that He sent to a whole nation for their disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of a lack of taqwa, a lack of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because when we have taqwa, taqwa is that thing that keeps us in check. Taqwa is that thing that will encourage us towards righteous good actions and to stay away from the sins. And part of the taqwa is the salah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. That indeed it is a prayer that prevents you from doing evil actions and haram actions. As-salah is that one thing which will help to build that taqwa in our hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions when the people didn't have taqwa, how He punished them. وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَحْلَ الْقُرَىٰ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبُوا فأخذناهم بما كانوا يكسبون. And if the people of the towns had believed and had taqwa, piety, certainly we should have opened for them blessings from the heaven and the earth. But they belied, I mean they denied the messengers, they didn't follow and obey the messenger Allah sent them. So we took them with a punishment for what they used to earn, for the actions that they used to do, such as doing shirk, such as following their desires and lusts, such as doing crimes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent their punishment. And we have a statement from amongst our salaf, the pious predecessors, the righteous pious predecessors, where one of them said, if you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant blessings to a certain person, and then you see that person continuing in their disobedience, continuing doing sins, then know that this is from Allah's plan against him. That if a person who has been given blessings from Allah, but he still does sins against Allah, then Allah has got a plan against this person. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, where he mentions, وَالَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا سَنَسْتَدْرِجُهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ وَأُمْلِي لَهُمْ إِنَّ كَيْدِي مَتِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that those who deny, who reject our ayat, such as the Quran, the proofs, Allah's signs, the revelation that came, those who reject these ayat, these signs, we shall gradually seize them with a punishment in ways that they will not perceive, they cannot think about. And Allah says, and I respite them, means Allah gives them a time that we doesn't punish them. Certainly my plan is strong. Brothers and sisters, one of the effects of sins is that sin will cause calamities to fall on us. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُّصِيبَةٍ فبما كسبت أيديكم ويعفو عن كثير. Whatever of a calamity falls on you, it's because of what your own hands have earned. Because of what your own hands have earned. And so that you can go back, return back to Allah and ask for His forgiveness. ويعفو عن كثير. Allah subhanahu is the one who pardons much. And again, Allah subhanahu mentions, مَا أَصَابَكَ مِنْ حَسَنَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatever good reaches you is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أَصَابَكَ مِنْ سَيِّئَةٍ فَمِنْ نَفْسِكَ. And whatever reaches you of evil, this is from yourselves. This is from yourself. You earn that. You see, in the time that have gone by, the previous nations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His mercy and His wisdom, will not punish the best of the nations, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He will not punish them like he did. And Shaykh Muhammad bin Salih al-Thaymin rahimahullah ta'ala explained this. He said that the people of Ad, they were punished with a single punishment. Sab'a layal, 7 days, 8 nights, Allah punished them. And how did He leave them? He left them like the hollow trunks, three trunks of a palm tree. Dead. Nothing left. Thamud, the people of Thamud, how did He seize them? As-sayha, a terrible cry, a shout, so deafening, that it made those people, whilst they're in their homes, to freeze with fear. To become corpses. They died in their homes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish this ummah in the same way, but rather He will punish them. Again, also to mention, one of the things which is in the news at the moment, the issue of homosexuality. And what really, I'm sorry to digress from the subject here, but it is linked to it, I suppose, as well. These actions, Allah mentions that these are the actions which were never done by a nation previously ever. But the people of Lut, Qawm Lut, they carried out these actions of homosexuality. Never before had these actions been done. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how did He deal with that people? Those persons, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down on them a punishment of what? a violent wind. Not only that, stones of baked clay falling down upon them, and the turning of their homes lifted up to the sky and smashed down until every one of them was dead. Why? Because of their disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the disobedience to their Prophet. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dealt with them. However, our ummah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept a different punishment for this ummah. And this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen that this ummah, part of it, will set itself on another part of it, so that they destroy each other, and they fight wars, and they take prisoners, and they do dhulm to each other. And is that not the case what we find today? Forget the non-Muslim lands, our Muslim lands, dhulm, fisq, oppression, disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Countries calling themselves Muslim countries, go and travel in the world. Allah says, see you fil ardh. If you want to see our hal today, and you see why do we have such weakness, we deal with riba, we deal with alcohol, we deal with prostitution. In our Muslim lands, we turned away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Sharia. So what do we expect? Allah's rahmah? Allah's amn, His security? When we do these things, when we enter these sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish those people. And if not today, it will be tomorrow. If not tomorrow, next week, next month, next year. But Allah's adab will come to them from the place they will never think it's coming from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
قُلْ هُوَ الْقَادِرُ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَبْعَثَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابًا مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ أَوْ مِنْ تَحْتِ أَرْجُلِكُمْ أَوْ يَلْبِسَكُمْ شِيَعًا وَيُذِيقَ بَعْضَكُمْ بَأْسَ بَعْضٍ انظُرْ كَيْفَ نُصَرِّفُ الْآيَاتِ انظر كيف نصرف الآيات لعلهم يفقهون.
Say, He has the power to send torment on you from above or from under you, from under your feet, or to cover you with confusion in party strife, meaning one group against the other, and make you taste the violence of one another. See how variously we explain the ayat, the proofs, so that you may understand. And today, we see the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst the Muslim lands. We see the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the non-Muslims onto the Muslims, that we become trampled and trodden under. But when we return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not change the condition of the people until the change was within themselves. So when they return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the izzah, the honor of the Muslims will rise again. And just as Islam came as a stranger, it will return as a stranger. And Islam will be more victorious. But that time will be when we as Muslims start to return back to our roots, following the Quran and Sunnah, and staying away from the sins, and having obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Qayyim rahmah ta'ala, the great scholar, described the effects of sins. One of these is that when a person indulges in sins, that person will be deprived of knowledge. Why? He mentions, rahimahullah, that ilm, knowledge, is nur, is light. It's a light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes to enter into your heart. And the opposite of that, light, darkness, is sin. Sins, ma'asiyah, dhunub. These things, they extinguish that light, they put that light out. Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, he sat before Imam Malik and started to read to him. And Imam al-Shafi'i would admire him because of the intelligence that he used to have, his alertness, his understanding of the religion, and what he saw in him, his good character. And Imam Malik used to say, regarding Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, I think Allah has caused a light to enter your heart, so don't extinguish it with the darkness of sin. Don't extinguish it with the darkness of sin. That the darkness covers the light. In order to remove that darkness, we have to go back to righteous good actions, avoidance of sins. One of the other, another thing is that when a person indulges in sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away that person's rizq. It could be in terms of his job, it could be in terms of his wealth, it could be in terms of his family. And this is from the authentic hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad, where the Prophet said it, the meaning of that a man is deprived of his provision, of his rizq, because of the sins that he commits. And of course, when we say a man, it refers in general to everybody, not only the men, but the sisters as well. When a person does sins, that person starts to create a barrier between him or herself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They start to alienate themselves from their Lord. And of course, in doing so, they alienate themselves from the righteous people as well. Because you cannot associate righteous people with sins. One of the Salaf, the righteous predecessors, said, if I disobey Allah, I see that in the attitude of my riding beast and my wife. That the effect of his sins, he sees it even in his mount, his horse or his camel, that he doesn't ride properly. All he sees in his wife, the character of his wife. Maybe she gives him a hard time. Sometimes many brothers complain about their wives giving them a hard time. Oh, she's a headache and this and that. But subhanAllah, what did Allah say? وَمَا أَصَابَكُمْ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَمِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُو عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. That the difficulties fall upon you, and he collapses because of your own hands have earned. So ask yourself, my brother, is your problem in your household because of what you are doing? Maybe we are the problems. Don't blame on the missus. Maybe we're the cause of it. When we are involved in sins, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes away from us that sakina, that tranquility and peace, that ease in the life for us, and instead puts difficulties for us. You find thorns in the path, or you find the thing you want to do becomes difficult. Maybe you want to apply for a job, you're not getting it. Maybe you want to marry a certain woman and you can't marry her. Maybe you don't get children. There's a reason. The hikmah, the wisdom of Allah, of course. But here, your means to attaining that thing may be blocked because of the sins that you do. Whereas another person wants the same thing, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the path easy. Didn't you read, my brothers and sisters? Didn't you hear the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ مَخْرَجًا وَبَيْزَ اللَّهِ keeps it due to him. Allah will make a way out for him. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. Whoever fears Allah keeps it due to him. And avoids those sins, of course. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a way out for him from sources they never thought possible. Taqwa, righteous actions, ease, easy way to get there. The opposite, ma'asiyah, dhamm, sins, transgression against Allah, hard way to get there. Maybe you don't reach that destination you want. When we deal with the heart, the scholars, such as Ibn Qayyim, they always talk about light and darkness. Because in general, light is associated with purity, and darkness with what? Evil. Yes? With not being illuminated, no guidance. And here, they mentioned, or Muqayyim mentioned, that obedience is light. Ta'a, obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the light of guidance. And disobedience, This is the dhulm. This is a type of oppression to yourself. This is dhulam, darkness. So you would not be guided. So the stronger the person is involved in a sin, the greater that darkness grows around them. And it confuses them. Just like if you're walking down a road and there's no light, you might make out certain objects, but even pitch black, you bump into this and bump into that. You knock your head, you might fall, trip over. Why? Without light, there is no path for you. So it's like a person who's making themselves blinder and blinder and blinder until they see nothing except darkness. And that is when they lead themselves into destruction. The saying of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he mentions, or he said, that when a person does good deeds, it makes the face light. It gives light to the heart and brings about ample provision. It means Allah SWT will give you a lot of rizq. It gives physical strength and love in people's hearts. But when you do sins, bad deeds, the face becomes dark. And it gives darkness to the heart and brings about physical weakness, mental weakness as well, and the lack of provision and hatred in people's hearts. So ask yourself, brothers and sisters, in which category do we fall? When a person persists in sins, the effect of that will be you will never be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you intended or as Allah wanted you to. Because this is now the opposite of obedience. And if by doing a sin, no punishment came to you at that time, but what it will do, it will prevent that person from doing an act of worship. In other words, the means to ibadah is being cut off. Your means, your path to doing righteous good deeds will be cut off, will be shortened, will be cut. And that is bad enough. Even with no punishment. That the fact that you will not be able to do more good deeds, if it's not good deeds, there's no in between. It's either good deeds or bad deeds. Amal salihat wa amal sayyiat. There's no in between. So your ability to carry out righteous good deeds will decrease as well. So the example given of such a person is like a man who eats food that will make that person to have a lengthy illness. That when you eat it, it's going to make you ill for a long time. And as a result of that, he will not be able to eat many other foods which are better than that. This is the analogy, the qiyas that's been given of the one who commits sins and persists in it. Sin, when you do sins, sins lead to more sins. It will dominate that person's life. Their friends will become sinners. Because nobody wants to be associated with a person who is openly sinful, unless the person themselves has no shame, has no haya, no modesty. Every one of us wants to be associated with good people. Every one of us. That's human nature. We don't be known as being hanging around with the wrong crowd. Doing those sins also decreases your willpower. Because the sin overtakes that person. And the struggle to do good and to stop themselves with evil, the balance tips until they're unable to prevent themselves, even if they wanted to, from doing a good deed and staying away from the bad deed. Even if the person then makes tawbah, repentance, the heart is not repentant. It's coming from the lips, but it's not truly from the heart. So they might be saying, Astaghfirullah, but it's from the lip only, from the lips only. They didn't mean it, had no effect in the heart. It became ad, it became normal. It's like, you know, in the Middle East, what some people say, how they use the words without any meaning. They say, inshallah. And it became to such an extent that even the non-Muslims Look at this, subhanAllah. They say, BMI. This is what a famous phrase in the Middle East they use. BMI. What does it stand for? Bukra, mumkin, inshaAllah. Which means, tomorrow, possibly, if Allah wills it. A'udhu billahi min kuffar. The non-Muslims are saying this. Oh, is it one of those BMIs? Bukra, mumkin, inshaAllah. Tomorrow, if possible, inshaAllah. Because it doesn't mean anything. We didn't have that yaqeen in our hearts, so we depended on that. That when we say insha'Allah, it means if Allah wills it, I will try my best to get it done, and I rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here, the same with repentance, tawbah. When someone says astaghfirullah, it didn't even exceed the throat. It didn't mean anything. And that kind of person, when they want to repent, it has no effect on them. Their hearts have now become like rocks. If you try to pour water on a rock, it simply slides off. Nothing penetrates it. So when you reach that stage, this is dangerous. You've destroyed yourself. Except Allah, if He has mercy upon you, and He softens your heart. And this is one of the most serious of diseases today. That people, they don't think much of sins. The companions, they used to say, the things that you think of minor today, in the time of the Prophet, they said, we used to think of this thing as it was like a mountain over our heads, would fall us and destroy us and crush us. And today, those people, they see the major sins as if a fly landed, like, just get rid of it like that. Allah understand. To the effect that the effect of that will be ultimately that we become desensitized. We don't feel it as a sin anymore. I'll give you an example, subhanAllah. When I was at university, a lovely friend of mine, mashallah, rahimahullah, he came from Yemen to study. And he said to me something one day. He said, you brothers, you don't understand about sins. You don't understand that being in a non-Muslim country, how it affects your heart. And he told me something. He said, the first day I came, I stepped off the plane and I landed in the UK. First time in my life, wallah, first time in my life, I saw naked legs. Meaning legs uncovered, women with skirts. He said, I felt so embarrassed, so shy. I didn't know where to look. I looked down, and there were naked legs. And then he said to me, but what happened? After some time being in this country, it became normal. It doesn't affect me anymore. And that's what happens to the heart. We don't think much of it. Today, on TV, you could see a scene of kissing. And some parents, may Allah guide us on them, they don't think much of it. No problem, it's not really bad. To that extent. So we ask this question, as some of the scholars have said, if you were with your children in your front room, would you allow a man and woman who are not mahram come into your house and start kissing and doing that in front of your children? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. We would never accept that. Unless somebody's plain crazy. And there's no taqwa in them. So even to that extent, when we watch TV, what the eyes see affects the heart. Because the poison arrow of shaitan enters through the eye and goes into the heart. And that's where the poison will spread. That's where the poison spreads. Until we reach that state where we'll become desensitized. It means nothing, it's no big deal. Wasn't a major thing that we saw. When we go outside, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command the men? Lower your gaze. Let's be honest. Let's be frank. How many of us can truly say, when I go out there, I lower my gaze? This is the zina, the eyes. Even for our sisters, that they should lower their gazes when they're talking to somebody. When we're at work, you deal with women sometimes. It's unavoidable. But do you sit and chat with that woman like she was a close friend of yours? Like you would with your wife or even more sometimes? Na'udhu billah. Do we sit in khalwa with women? This is something forbidden for us. Sometimes it is unavoidable. But we should try our utmost in that situation. I remember our Sheikh when he used to study in the UK. He told us an incident that happened. He had to do an assignment for his PhD, and they put him to groups. And on purpose, their tutor put them in mixed pairs, male, female. He asked them, you have to get an assignment pair, a male and a female. And the Sheikh, thinking, Ya Allah, what am I going to do? I'm supposed to have a woman, and I can't do anything about this, this is my assignment. So he looked around to the asked, what do you do, Sheikh? He said, I looked around the room, and I looked for the woman who looked most like a man. The lesser of the two evils. Why? To prevent himself at least having any desire to that woman. The lesser of the evils. So whatever we can, we try to feel Allah as much as we can. We try to stay away from the sin. By doing so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, if we stay with the major sins we mentioned, then the minor sins will be forgiven. And with that, we're going to end with our introduction to the major sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the seven heinous sins. Or the Prophet informed us, avoid the seven heinous sins, those which are very, very bad, very severe. And we mentioned worshipping others with Allah, doing sihr, sorcery, magic, taking a life which Allah has made sacred except in the course of justice, eating riba interest, taking the orphan's property without any right and just cause, running away from the battlefield in jihad, and making false accusations to the believing women that they committed adultery. So these are the seven we mentioned, and as we said, that Ibn Abbas mentioned that they're not the seven, rather they're 70. Now, to go through all 70 of the sins, we'll probably need 70 lectures. We don't have that time, of course. So what we're going to be doing is taking a selection of them, trying to summarize some of them. And we're going to start with the greatest of the sins. And who can remind us? Because I'm getting old.
Shirk.
What is shirk?
Associating with Allah and somebody else.
Yes. To associate anything in worship or anybody, to make a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either through His Lordship, His Rubbiyah, through His worship, Uluhiyah, or Ibadah, or through His Asma wa Sifat, through His names and attributes. That is the shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we ask this question, why is it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this as the sin, which is above all the greatest of sins? Anybody? Our brother. Yes, but that is the case. You to make a preference of somebody else, not only make a preference, to make a partnership. How can anybody make a partnership knowingly, when we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created us, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked us to worship Him alone, whether this be a stone or a tree or a moon, a prophet or an angel, a sheikh, anybody, angel, whatever. This is the greatest of sins that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says is unforgivable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive the sin of joining worship with others, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But He forgives, other than this, to whosoever He pleases. Some sins are greater than others we mentioned. And this is the sin. It is the sin which is head and tails above the rest of all other sins. And whoever did this sin, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever sets up partners in worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah has forbidden paradise for that person. فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ. So whoever set apart with Allah and worship, that Allah has forbidden paradise for that person, and the fire will be their abode. The fire will be their resting place. And for the wrongdoers who do these actions, there are no helpers. Nobody can save that person. So this is the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the sin of shirk, singled it out. Any other sin, yes, if Allah wants to forgive that. But this is the single one sin which is unforgivable. For the person who did this action and died upon these actions of shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbidden entry into paradise for that person, even if they claim to be a Muslim. Then we have, similarly on the same line, another type of shirk. So this is the major shirk. The major shirk. Then we have what is called a lesser or a minor shirk, a shirk asghar, which is known in English as ostentation, showing off, doing actions for someone else's pleasure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَمَنْ كَانَ يُرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that whoever expects to meet his Lord, then let him work righteousness, good actions, and in the worship of his Lord, admit no one as partner. That when you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you never ever have a partner in that worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, in the partnership of that is also to do an action other than for Allah. We have been commanded, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهِ. How? مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. That we have not been commanded, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except but with sincerity. Sincerity, with ikhlas. When we worship Him alone. We ask Him alone. We recognize the fact no one can help, no one can answer our prayers except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that our actions, our ibadah is directed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The minute that we do an action to please somebody else, it could be your brother, it could be your wife, it could be your parents, it could be the sheikh, it could be somebody who's watching you in the masjid, it could be for a non-Muslim. If you're showing off, if that niyyah, if that intention was not correct, then that action is worthless. Then that becomes minor shirk. What the Prophet feared, shirk al-riya. In the meaning of the hadith, he said the thing he feared for his ummah was the minor shirk, and he described it as similar to a black ant crawling on a black rock on a dark night. It's hidden, it's not easy to distinguish, but that is the thing which can ruin all our actions. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ told us, beware of the minor shirk. When the companions asked him, what is the minor shirk? He ﷺ told them, showing off in doing good works. That you're doing righteous actions, but you're showing off to the doing it for the people. You didn't do it for Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to the humankind, on the day that we're supposed to be rewarded for our actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, go to those people that you showed off in the world to and see how they will reward you. Is there any other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day will reward? Of course not. So on that day, whoever did an action for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then two things. Allah will free himself from that person, and the Prophet will also dissociate himself from that person. And the Prephet said to me in the hadith, if anybody associates something with me, I'm not affected. If anyone associates somebody with me in any way, I reject him and his act of associating, doing shirk. And the Prophet said that the person who does any good action in order to boast, to show the people, will have his faults exposed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person whose motive in doing a good deed is to show off, to show it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat that person as a hypocrite. A'udhu billahi min dhalik. We seek Allah's refuge from such Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having an opinion of us as such. A wise man once said, just as the one who shows off in good works is like the one who fills his purse or his wallet with pebbles, stones, and leaves to go off to the market to buy food. If he opened it to pay, showing this is when I'm going to pay you, he'll have the stones thrown back in his face. He gains nothing except about people will start to inquire about what was in his purse, nothing more. So the one who shows off when they're doing actions of good, those actions will be having no value, but the people will only say that he did good. And in the Akhirah, for that person, there is no reward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about those people, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ حَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. And we shall turn to whatever deeds they did, and we shall make such deeds scattered as floating particles of dust. So we are warned against doing actions of showing off. That here, we should not show off. The Prophet ﷺ told us, when he was asked, if I do some actions which are showing off, how can I redeem myself? How am I to be forgiven? The Prophet ﷺ said, if you do not deceive Allah. The man asked, how is Allah deceived? He replied, when you do something which Allah His Messenger commanded you to do, but you intend other pleasing Allah, beware of ostentation. Beware of riya. It is a lesser shirk on the day of judgment. Those who did these actions for other than Allah, we call in front of all of the mankind. And they'll be called, oh you who showed off, oh ostentatious, oh traitors, oh corrupt, oh loser. What you did is you wasted your reward. It's nullified. You wasted your actions. We will not reward you. Go and get your reward from whoever you acted to deceive. So brothers and sisters, now we come to the end of our first part on the major sins. These are the sins which we need to save our souls with or from. If we manage to stay away from these, then inshallah ta'ala, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful to us and it forgives our minor sins, that we inshallah ta'ala will be resurrected with the prophets and the martyrs and the righteous people into the gardens under which rivers flow. There we will live forever. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu alayk. Jazakumullahu khair, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.